Let us rejoice and be glad, for this is the day that the Lord has made. Our opening hymn is hymn number 52. Welcome.
I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule by day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word and then pronounced them good. Lord, how your wonders are displayed where'er I turn my eye. If I survey the ground I tread or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or flower below but makes your glories known. And clouds arise and tempests blow by order from your throne. While all that borrows life from you is ever in your care, and everywhere that I may be, you, God, are present there.
Welcome to this worship service today. We welcome Brent Sjaardema to our pulpit, and we invite all of you to the fellowship hour following the service in the Peace Lounge. You'll want to make note of the announcements in the bulletin today about upcoming events. Next week and the week following, we'll be highlighting the work of Habitat. That will begin next week. Next week, there will be a council meeting following the service, and on the 27th, there'll be an annual meeting to which you are invited that will be held after the service. Today, there's a special celebration for baby Mia, who is going to be born in February. She is the first grandchild of the Davilas, so you're welcome to come and join in the celebration at 3:00. Next weekend is a very special weekend, the Martin Luther King Celebration Weekend. The details of the program are in your bulletin, and you'll want to try to attend as many as possible. Friday evening at the library in Ridgewood, there will be the film King in the Wilderness at 7:00, followed by discussion of the film. And if you are able to attend, please call the library to reserve your seat. On Saturday, there'll be a wonderful program in Glen Rock at the All Saints Episcopal Church, and the Attorney General of New Jersey is going to be a speaker along with a panel, so you'll want to come if you are able to at 4:00. Then on Sunday afternoon at 4:00, there'll be a wonderful gospel choir concert at Mount Bethel Church. And then on Monday will be the usual annual interfaith service at the Methodist Church in Ridgewood, which will be followed then by a community luncheon. And so hopefully you'll be able to attend some of those events. And I believe that ends the announcements for today.
So this is Across the Universe by a band you may have never heard of before called The Beatles, not sure. It revolves around this central mantra, Jaya Guru Deva Om. It is Sanskrit and it more or less embodies or translates to the idea of a mind or a transcendent state of mind, so to speak, so as to allow oneself to become enveloped with the love of the world, the peace and the unity of the world. Yeah, and I'm very happy to share it with you all today.
Jaya Guru Deva.
Thank you. It's wonderful to hear a variety of music in church. Having grown up during the 1960s, it's wonderful to hear a rendition from the Beatles. I'm going to do something a little different in the responsive reading this morning. It was suggested to me at coffee hour that I also read the section where it says people, which I will do this morning so that it facilitates the streaming. And people that are listening online would be able to enjoy the responsive reading as well. So I will read both the section for the leader, the people, and for the unison section as well. Let's share together. Come, believers and faithful ones, sing your alleluias to God. Praise God who invades us with the rush of a mighty wind and fills us with fire. Praise God who out of love sent Jesus Christ to live among us. Praise God whose spirit is poured out upon all flesh so our sons and daughters might prophesy. God reaches into our lives and claims us, calling us honored and loved. We are God's people. We are redeemed, for God has called us by name. Come, Holy Spirit, and find us in our wilderness. Lead us forth into the wonders of your love.
The first scripture reading this morning is from Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 31. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness. And let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, and over every living creature that moves on the ground." Then God said, "I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth, and all the birds of the air, and all the creatures that move on the ground, everything that has breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Bear with me, my voice is not mine this morning. The second reading is from Amos, chapter 5, verses 23 and 24. "Away with the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the music of your harps, but let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream." The third scripture reading is from Galatians chapter 3, verses 23 through 29. "Before this faith came, we were held prisoners by the law, locked up until faith should be revealed. So the law was put in charge to lead us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. Now that faith has come, we are no longer under the supervision of the law. You are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have been clothed with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you're all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise."
Let's rise as we are able and join together in singing hymn number 629. Let's sing it through twice.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in their place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in their place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send them love, send us power, send us grace.
We come now to our time of prayer, and we will want to notice the prayer concerns on the prayer list today. We'll want to keep the Osborne family in our prayers. As you know, Joe Osborne's mother passed away on the 3rd of January. Pastor Gill's mother, Isabel, also has health concerns. We'll want to keep her in our prayers. Sammy's son, Mark, has returned home from the hospital and is recovering now at home, and we'll want to keep him in our prayers for continued healing. And also, the Shaners have had health issues this week, but are now at home recovering, and please remember them in your prayers as well. And I wonder if you have others you would like to name for us to keep in our prayers today. Let us then join our hearts in prayer. Compassionate God, we give you thanks for bringing us to this new day, and we thank you for the new year ahead. Help us, we pray, to live each and every day of this new year with gratitude for your goodness to us, and all the gifts of your Spirit, which you so generously give. Help us to open our hearts to you and receive your gifts of love and joy, peace and patience, kindness and generosity, faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. Help us to open our hearts to one another and invite your Spirit into all our relationships. Empower us to witness to your inclusive love that binds us all together. Help us to open our hearts to all who are in need. We pray for those we have just named, and for those we now name in our hearts. Help us to discern what you would have us do in the midst of all the suffering and all the need in the world. We pray that throughout this new year, our life and ministries as a church may bring blessing to many. We pray in the name of Jesus, who shows us the way and who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The morning offering will be received. Thank you. Heavenly Mother and Father, we give you thanks for the blessings that you have shared with us. We are grateful to be able to give back some of those blessings for your kingdom. We ask that you would bless these offerings and gifts and tithes, that you would multiply them as you multiplied the bread and the fish of old, and that you would build your kingdom upon a solid rock. We give you thanks, honor, and glory. We ask for healing upon our land. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Last week, Pastor Lewis gave a sermon called Let's Go Places, coming out of the Toyota commercial. He revealed something that I have in common with Pastor Ken as well, and that we're car guys. It brought back some memories. My dad had a 1956 DeSoto. Many people here probably don't remember the DeSoto, which was a car that was put out by the Chrysler Corporation. I think it met its demise at about 1959 or 1960. He had a 56 fire dome, and it had a push-button transmission in it. Four settings on the transmission. There was no park. It had neutral, drive, low, and reverse. And it was right on the left-hand side. You pushed one of those buttons, and the car took off. I used to love to say to my dad, push a button and away we go. The question is where we went. Well, I really didn't care. I just enjoyed being in a car and moving out. But I think as a church community, we have something more to consider. We have to consider where we're headed, how we serve God, and how we do it. The sermon topic today is the big tent. In many cases, the Christian community has recognized that the church is not the building. And in fact, many crusades and many Christian movements were started in tents. Hawthorne Gospel started in a tent on Lafayette Avenue, where the Hawthorne Lewis Bay II Library is now located. They moved to a wooden structure called the Tabernacle, further down on Lafayette Avenue. A firehouse now stands there. And then Pastor Herman Bronlin recognized that Route 208 was going to be a transportation hub. There was a bar that stood there, and probably the first time in his life that he went into a bar, he bought the place. And now the campus stands there as well. Charles Finney had a tent ministry. Billy Graham had a tent ministry with some of his early crusades before he went to places like Madison Square Garden and the Meadowlands. The question is, though, where we go with ministry. We need to recognize that the church is not the building. We have a beautiful building here, and it is really nice to come into a beautiful sanctuary. It was beautiful at Christmas time to see the Christmas decorations here. A few remnants of them still remain because they have a place to give warmth in the winter cold months. But on the other hand, the church is not the building, the church is the people. And the question is, where do we go? I was reading in Newsweek this week a presentation on politics. And my two favorite subjects are politics and religion, which my grandmother said, if you want to remain friends with people, don't discuss politics or religion. But I'm still friends with everybody, even though those are my favorite subjects. But Joe Kennedy III wrote an article for Newsweek. Joe Kennedy is the grandson of Robert F. Kennedy, a lawyer and a U.S. representative in Massachusetts' 4th Congressional District since 2013. He writes about John Lewis, who was a representative, an African-American representative from Georgia. John Lewis, before he became a member of Congress, had been arrested 40 times and beaten and nearly killed for standing up for social justice, for advocating inclusivity, and for advocating a change within America to make America a more perfect union. Kennedy indicates that Lewis was at the memorial service at Mother Emanuel Church in Charleston, South Carolina, and listening to loved ones who had lost members to that horrific shooting. And he got up as part of the memorial service to talk about forgiveness. He said that our nation had learned to forgive. And he told a story about when he was 21, he was beaten by Ku Klux Klan members in South Carolina. Years later, a man came into his congressional office with his son and asked for him by name. He said that he was one of the members of the Klan who had beaten him in previous years, and that he had come with his child to apologize. They hugged and both cried. There is a sense of forgiveness there. We are blessed in the Christian community for knowing that Christ paid the price on the cross for our forgiveness, that we have an opportunity to come clean, that we have an opportunity to reconcile with God through his Son, Jesus Christ. A second article in Newsweek was from Barack Obama. He reflected on Robert Kennedy, who in 1968 was assassinated. Last year, it was 50 years since Robert Kennedy was assassinated in Los Angeles. President Obama indicated that Kennedy argued for unity over division, for compassion over mutual suspicion, for justice over intolerance and inequality. He indicated that there are ripples of hope. There's a legacy that Robert Kennedy has left with us, a legacy of inclusion from the time when he stood on a beat-up car 50 years ago and launched his presidential campaign. The Statue of Liberty, for me, has always been a symbol of hope, of outreach, of the best that America has to offer. I say the best that America has to offer because sometimes it has not lived up to the light which Lady Liberty carries in the harbor. Emma Lazarus wrote a poem called The New Colossus, which is on a plaque in the base of the Statue of Liberty. And she writes, "Not like the brazen giant of Greek fame, with conquering limbs astride from land to land, here at our sea-washed sunset gate shall stand a mighty woman with a torch, whose flame is the imprisoned lightning, and her name, Mother of Exiles. From her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome. Her mild eyes command the air-bridged harbor that twin cities frame. Keep, ancient lands, your storied pomp," cries she with silent lips. "Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door." That poem reminds me of one of the scripture readings that we had this morning from Amos, where Amos shared, "Away with your noise of your songs. I will not listen to the music of your harps. But let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream." Keep your ancient lands with storied pomp, Emma writes. Very similar to Amos and the noise that was made with the Israelites in ancient Israel, Palestine, and following that, of course, the exile in Babylon. Martin Luther King, whose legacy we will celebrate in those activities which Pastor Judy outlined for next week, wrote a letter on the 16th of April of 1963, 100 years after Abraham Lincoln had proclaimed in the Gettysburg Address that all men are created equal. Martin Luther King, 100 years later, wrote it, "My dear fellow clergymen." And that's the word he used, "my dear fellow clergymen." Pastor Linda shared with me one time that a professor at Eastern College had indicated to her, "You can't be a pastor, but you can marry a pastor." I said, "Well, Pastor Linda, that professor was half right, because she did marry a pastor, that was Harry. But of course, that professor was half wrong as well, since Linda shared her gifts of ministry with this congregation." I intentionally used the word mother and father in addressing God in the offertory prayer today, as it's written, mother and father, for the Lord's Prayer. And some may say, well, it's not written that way in the Bible, but of course, would we do a hermeneutic or an evaluation of the Bible, we must remember the context and the culture in which it was written, because culture has a huge impact. In those days, the word man often meant humankind. And in fact, in our reading from Genesis, it specifically outlined that God made men and women in his image or her image, if we want to be inclusive in our reading and hermeneutic of scripture from that era. When Martin Luther King conducted his ministry, he seemed to me to be a prophet in a latter day. He wrote a letter to the clergy people in 1963, and that letter still rings true today as an admonition to the church community, because he wrote in one of his paragraphs in a letter from a Birmingham jail when he was incarcerated. John Lewis was arrested 40 times. Of course, Martin Luther King was arrested as well. We have the distinction here of our dear brother Don, that was arrested for standing up for environmental integrity in the United States. That reading from Genesis also talks about ruling over the earth. In some texts it reads having dominion. I'm not going to go on a side tangent and talk about the environment today, but that is also an opportunity for a future sermon. But Martin Luther King writes, "Perhaps I have once again been too optimistic." He's writing to his fellow clergy people. "Is organized religion too inextricably bound to the status quo to save our nation and the world? Perhaps I must turn my faith to the inner spiritual church, the church within the church, as the true ecclesia and the hope of the world. But again, I am thankful to God that some noble souls from the ranks of organized religion have broken loose from the paralyzing chains of conformity and joined us as active partners in the struggle for freedom. They have left their secure congregations and walked the streets of Albany, Georgia with us. They have gone down the highways of the South on torturous rides for freedom. Yes, they have gone to jail with us. Some have been dismissed from their churches, have lost the support of their bishops and fellow ministers. But they have acted in the faith that right defeated is stronger than evil triumphant. Their witness has been spiritual salt that has preserved the true meaning of the gospel in these troubled times. They have carved a tunnel of hope through the dark mountain of disappointment. I hope the church as a whole will meet the challenge of this decisive hour But even if the church has not come to the aid of justice, I have no despair about the future. I have no fear about the outcome of our struggle in Birmingham, even if our motives are at present misunderstood. We will reach the goal of freedom in Birmingham and all over the nation because the goal of America is freedom. Abused and scorned though we may be, our destiny is tied up with America's destiny. Before the Pilgrims landed at Plymouth, we were here. Before the pen of Jefferson etched the majestic words of the Declaration of Independence across the pages of history, we were here. For more than two centuries, our forebears labored in this country without wages. They made cotton king. They built the homes of their masters while suffering gross injustice and shameful humiliation. And yet, out of a bottomless vanity, they continue to thrive and develop. If the inexpressible cruelties of slavery could not stop us, the oppression we face surely will fail. We will win our freedom because the sacred heritage of our nation and the eternal will of God are embodied in our echoing demands. Before closing, I feel impelled to mention one other point in your statement that has troubled me profoundly. You warmly commended the Birmingham Police Force for keeping order and preventing violence. I doubt that you would have warmly commended the police force if you had seen its dogs sinking their teeth into unarmed, nonviolent Negroes. I doubt that you would have quickly commended the policemen if you were to observe their ugly and humane treatment of the Negroes here in the city jail, if you were to watch them push and curse old Negro women and young Negro girls, if you were to see them slap and kick old Negro men and young boys, if you were to observe them as they did on two occasions, refused to give us food because we wanted to sing our grace together, I cannot join you in the praise of the Birmingham Police Department. The word Negro in there was perhaps not as politically correct as we look at it today, but these were the words of Martin Luther King, keeping in mind that this was written in 1963. What is the message here to the church of today? Have things changed all that much? We see children separated from parents on our southern border. It's not only America, we're bound up with the world community as well. That's one disagreement that I have with Dr. King. For I was reading an article in Time magazine this week about a Syrian refugee family in Germany. The husband was becoming increasingly frustrated. His wife was finding an easier time becoming assimilated to German culture and the German way of life. She had abandoned the hijab. He was concerned because he was having difficulty learning German. His reaction was to take their daughter and surreptitiously move out of Germany, returning to Syria, putting his daughter in danger, even though the family had been granted asylum in Germany. The mother could not leave Germany because to leave Germany would have jeopardized her asylum status in Germany. The child was not recognized as a German citizen in Syria. And although they were able to keep in touch by Skype, the child is at risk, the mother is divided, the father is back in Syria, putting the family in jeopardy. But the frustration of that situation is something that is very telling in terms of the human experience. It is a cultural divide. The world today is smaller. It's made smaller by communications, by instantaneous Skype, by cell phone, by being in touch. But culture doesn't change that much. And so how do we appreciate culture in a church? I think the way we appreciate culture is looking at it as a learning opportunity. A few years ago, The Davila family celebrated with us Bolivian dancers. It was a night of celebration and a night of enlightenment to see another culture in operation. We have opportunities to learn because America, and particularly this region in America, is so alive with multifaceted culture. It's something that we should embrace, something that we should say that we're grateful for. God has made us men, women, as God's people. Paul wrote, "We are neither Jew nor Gentile, slave nor free. We are all one in Christ." Christ Jesus is who reconciles us. We need to recognize and appreciate our separate cultures and what we bring to the table and say, this is God's blessing. We exclude nobody. We embrace diversity. We give God thanks for diversity and the opportunity to learn, to share, and to grow within that rich heritage. And yet, we can misuse some of that diversity. There were those in the South, and in fact, those in the North, that said, well, slavery is mentioned in the Bible, so slavery is a legitimate way to structure the human condition. Just because slavery is mentioned in the Bible doesn't mean it's right. The Bible was counseling us to move away from human bondage, to more openness, to more inclusivity. It said, masters, be kind to your slaves. There was a reciprocity that was required there. And so if it morphed into employment as opposed to slavery, that was a good thing. But yet employment sometimes morphs into exploitation, where people are paid unfairly, not compensated for the just labor that they provide. The Bible counsels us that we should pay just wages to those that are working and supporting us. In the church, we need to speak out against injustice. We need to speak out for right. That's one exciting thing that's happening here at Emmanuel Baptist Church is the forum, which brings many faith traditions together to explore issues of justice, equality, and freedom of expression and freedom of faith. We as Baptists have a label here that this pulpit is dedicated to the free expression of the gospel. That is a sacred tradition. We as Baptists have an opportunity for that free proclamation of the gospel, and we must accept divergent viewpoints in how that faith is expressed. Some may say God is a man. Others may say that God is beyond being put in a box, that we need to look at the totality of God, and should God not reflect the humanness in the tradition in which God made humankind? Should we not recognize that God has made this world a special place, and it has given us an obligation, particularly an obligation within the church, to be inclusive, to reach out, not to say no. Pastor Lewis last week talked about an experience of his son in a Catholic church. He talked about his son going forward and sharing communion where the invitation was just to Catholics. And he tried to get his son Demetrius not to go forward, but Demetrius' position was very Baptist. Demetrius' position was, this is the Lord's table. No one should keep you away from the Lord's table. And so Demetrius shared communion. I am privileged to say that I shared Catholic communion with Pastor Lewis this past week at the funeral service for Joe Osborne's mother, which was done very beautifully in a Catholic church. In that sanctuary of St. Mary's in Pompton Lakes, there was a beauty. Some of the hymns were very familiar. There was a blessing in hearing the Magnificat, because it's from Scripture, and it shows the magnificence of Jesus Christ and his willing to make a sacrifice for humankind on the cross. Heidi read the eulogy, and although I did not know Joe's mother personally, I developed an understanding of Joe's mother as an outstanding individual that she was, and the legacy that she left here, and that is a legacy that we all leave. That is part of what we need to do as far as leaving a legacy as a church community. God has given us a task in being part of this church family. We answer that call with our benevolence, with our outreach. For 2 weeks, we will have an opportunity with Habitat for Humanity to do that outreach by signing boards, which will be eventually placed in homes in Patterson for people who are given an opportunity to put their rung on the hand, or their hand on the rung of home ownership. It's an opportunity that we have to share with those families and also to give a donation to Habitat for Humanity for them being able to increase these opportunities for families. It's inspirational to go to a Habitat dinner and see families who are burning their mortgage and to see them making that progress. You may say, well, that's just one family, or maybe that's even in Patterson, over 200 families that Patterson Habitat has helped. How many more are there in the world? There are. There are more things that can be done. But if Patterson Habitat did not help those families, they wouldn't be in a better position. We are called to reach out. And that ultimate calling is the ministry of Jesus Christ himself. Jesus was willing to pay the price on the cross. Jesus was willing to speak truth to power. Jesus was willing to stand up to the devil in the wilderness. Jesus was willing to be truthful and faithful to God, even to the extent of giving his life on the cross. We are called to be servants in the model of Jesus' servant leadership. This is the calling that we have from Christ. This is the calling of our church, to be inclusive rather than exclusive, to have our doors open, to be a big tent, to gather people together and recognize that this is our calling in ministry, to be inclusive, to share with one another, to be willing to listen, to be willing to embrace change, to be willing to hear the Beatles in the midst of our service and enjoy that. It was wonderful. Thank you. To be willing to learn from culture, even as culture changes. The Beatles song was keeping things constant. But we can't stay complacent. Church does give us comfort, but we have to have comfort in moving forward as well. As I said to my dad in that 1956 DeSoto, push a button and away we go. We must work together to find out what buttons to push, and then work together, and away we go. May God bless us in that sacred journey.
Thank you.
take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
May God bless us as we go forward, brothers and sisters walking together on this journey of life. May Christ be our guide, our salvation, and our spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
There comes a time when we heed a certain call, when the world must come together as one. There are people dying, oh, and it's time to lend a hand to life, the greatest gift of all.
We can't go
Please join us for coffee hour in the Peace Lounge.